what? I found a guy yesterday played just as bad as walking to him. And his name was Dak Prescott. Mm. And he's a little further north than what walking to him was playing.
Was it raining in Philadelphia? Nope.
What was the weather?
It looked nice.
The wind was blowing about 40, about 30.
It was not. It was not.
Oh, sorry. So it was ideal conditions?
It wasn't ideal.
Okay, then. Okay. Anyway, hold on. If you play football, what the hell you think this is, a gymnasium? Mm. Every game might be wind, snow, rain, sleet, sunshine, but to play outdoors. So I don't do it. Skip, I told you I had to get out of the excuse-making business because people got, they didn't want to buy them anymore. Mm. They say, if you play pro sports, I'm tired of all these excuses, Shannon. So I said, okay, I got Dubs and Nails. Mm. And guess who came? Oh, they came to see me. I told you, I had a good old chowder. Had a little good old chowder air for Dak Prescott, Skip Bayless.
So now, wait, I got to get this straight. So now your restaurant serves only losers. Right?
Yeah.
That's a new thing.
Look, I got two areas. I got a little small little storefront. I only got like 1,500 square feet. Do you know what property costs like in this area to get a big old restaurant? So I got a little.
And that's why it's moved about four times, right?
Yeah, pop-up shop.
Moving.
And so, you know, I got a patio because everybody got to have a patio you in L.A.
Yeah.
But anyway, I had this old pop-up shop that serves chowder. Mm-hmm. Skip Bayless, at some point in time, you're going to realize, everybody keeps telling you about Dak, but if Dak is what you said he is, the weather should not be an issue. I told you, this game was tailor-made for old Zeke Elliott, but y'all didn't want to do it. Oh, no, why you running Zeke? Fred, Jerry, stop it! That's what you came out here and said last week. You remember? You don't want to run it on first down. Mm-hmm. But if you put the ball in 21's hand yesterday, he'd have brought you home. Mm. But you put it in four hands, and now you're going back with the tail between your legs, and now your owner is talking crazy again.
Quick point of order. I know you don't listen to the sound.
I do not.
The great Joe Buck and the great Troy Aikman made a point during the Fox telecast that in speaking with Belichick the day before, they got the feeling that Belichick was far more concerned about stopping the pass than he was about stopping the run, that he seemed unconcerned about stopping Zeke Elliott because everybody has been stopping Zeke Elliott. I will give you, he ran harder and better yesterday than I have seen him all year long.
We're feeding him, Skip. Feed him!
My quarterback threw for 110 in the fourth quarter. That's how you come back on Tom Brady. If you give Tom Brady a lead at Gillette Stadium, he's 105-1. 105-1, and he would be 106-0, except that Belichick's defense fell apart in that home opener against Alex Smith and the Kansas City Chiefs going back to 2017. They led that 17-14 at halftime and lost 42-27.
Okay. This is what I'm going to promise you at the beginning of the season, and this is what I'm going to promise you the week before. Your defense would allow Tom Brady to have 190 passing yards. He would throw one touchdown, and we're only going to give up 13 points. Do you take it or you leave it?
If you tell me that it's a driving rain all game long with 30-mile-an-hour winds, I will take it and run with it. Because speaking of the great Troy Aikman, I covered him when he played pro football. He now resides along with you in the Pro Football Hall of Fame. Wouldn't you agree with that?
I would
Thank
agree.
You. Troy Aikman, to save his life, could not throw a wet football because it gets heavy and it gets slick, and he just could not grip the ball.
Yeah, so, most quarterbacks don't like playing
that. Okay, thank you very much. Well, he said yesterday during the telecast late in the second quarter, if we could hear this, I think we have the Troy Aikman sound on this, what he said about throwing a wet football.
Troy, I had actually heard from a little birdie that works with the Dallas Cowboys when you played back when there was rain potentially in the forecast. I mean, nobody would sleep in the organization because you were so worried about it.
Well, if they couldn't sleep, you can imagine how little sleep I got. I had no chance in conditions like this.
Huh. So Troy Aikman says, I had no chance in conditions like this. And you're saying, Dak Prescott, if he's that guy, he should just suck it up and play.
Hold on. Who wrote the article that what Dak Prescott doing, Roger Staubach, Troy Aikman, Tony Romo, none of them can touch it?
Well, those were stats.
Thank you very much. But you harp on those stats, Skip.
Okay, so I'm going to give you this. Dak Prescott had two soirees into the red zone.
And what happened?
And you have to cash one. Two soirees into the red zone.
And what happened?
And you have to cash one, albeit against a defense that is number one in the league on third down. So it's hard to convert against them. They just don't give up red zone touchdowns. But the first time happened late in the first half. And they got it all the way down to first and 10 at the New England 14. And they gave it to your man, Ezekiel Elliott. He got three. Not bad. It wasn't a bad run, but he got three. And then all of a sudden, I don't know what happened. It looked like Zeke waved out, but he went straight to the sideline. I don't know why. And he took it, but put a coat on him, and he stood like, I'm going to watch the rest of this. And my man, little Tony Pollard, comes in.
And what happened?
And all of a sudden, first play is just a little dink pass over the middle. It's a check down pass, and they're all over him and break it up. And then on third down, they throw a screen pass to Tony Pollard that goes for all of 2 yards.
Wait a minute.
I don't know. So where's Zeke? I'm not sure if he took himself out or if they took him out.
Hold on, time out. I just read an article last week that the Cowboys' offense is more explosive with Tony Pollard in it. Somebody just wrote an article. You keep telling me Tony Pollard is more explosive.
No, they were 6-0 when he plays at least 12 snaps.
Okay. And so Zeke says, you know what I'm going to do? I read that article. I'm going to get me one of these old jackets. I'm going to get warm right quick. Hey, Tony, you up?
Okay, well, he may have. It looked like he went right out of the game.
And what happened?
Like he was ready to go out of the game.
Here's the thing. You keep telling me about how good the Patriots are on third down and their red zone defense. If Dak is that guy, if Dak is that dude, he's got to bring this home. So don't tell me, Skip. See, now when you played Miami and when you played Washington and you played the Giants, everybody's telling you about how good Dak is. I need him to beat a good team.
Okay, so here we go again. Second soiree into the red zone comes early in the fourth quarter after he'd hit Randall Cobb for 47 yards. And if Randall Cobb was a little bit faster, he might have scored on that play, but he's a slot receiver.
The injury, Skip, doesn't do nothing, robbed him of the breakaway speed.
He's not that guy anymore. But there he goes. Go, Randall, go. Oh, I thought for a second he was just gone.
No, you did.
And if he'd been gone, we'd be having a different conversation.
No, you did. Thank you.
I did. For about 1 second, I thought he's going to turn the corner and be gone.
If he was Tyreek Hill or Julio, maybe.
Okay.
So not Randall.
They get the ball all the way down to first and 10 once again at the 14. And on the first play of this little soiree, they run a college wishbone option left that they haven't run all year, where you go all the way to read the defensive end and then either pitch it or keep it.
Right.
And at the last second, he pitches it to Zeke, and it doesn't go very far. Okay.
He's
lucky they kept the ball.
Because you see that corner, Skip, that corner there in cover two, you see that corner forcing this?
Do I love the call? I do not love the call into the near side of the field. So now it's second and 7 from the 11, and here's the play of the game to me. He bolts right, Dak does, from the pocket, and actually makes a very good on-the-run throw to your man, Jason Witten, and it looks like it's got a chance because he's got Patrick Chung on his backside. He shielded off Patrick Chung, but guess who makes the play of the game?
Stephon Gilmore.
So not only does he take Amari Cooper out of the game, he comes off Amari Cooper to dive, and he has to flat out dive to nick this ball and knock it away.
You know why Stephon Gilmore knocked that play down? Because he can't throw the look, no look like my homeboy. My homeboy would have stared down Amari Cooper, threw it to the sidearm, and you'd have had a touchdown. See, that's why you do things like that, Skip.
Okay, so then on third down, it's third and seven. He rolls to his left as Dak Prescott. Here's the one again.
Yep.
That was a heck of a play.
That'd have been a touchdown by my homeboy, though.
Yeah, well, I think it was about to be a touchdown by Dak. This time he goes left, bolting the pocket, and throws crossbody to Blake Jarwin, who Dak Prescott says just might be the best athlete on our team, and Blake Jarwin cannot get his feet down. And it's possible you could have gotten your feet down on this play. It's possible if you had better presence. Mm. But guess what Blake Jarwin was doing before the ball was snapped? He was looking up at Dak going like this, like, I don't know what I'm doing. It looked like, what am I supposed to do? I think he just sort of freelanced a route. I think he didn't know what the play was.
Yeah, you know why? Because he body caught it. Now, if he goes up there and catches the ball with his hands, now...
Because you got to focus on where because you're throwing with the wind, did it sail just a touch? It sailed just a touch, but would Shannon Sharp have made that play? He just might have made that play.
How did you plug the guy both feet down?
Sure.
Yeah. Okay.
No denying that.
So, again,
put the ball behind my back.
I'll give you this. My quarterback didn't make either one of those plays, although both had a chance.
Your quarterback made no plays. Okay. Stop talking about him making either one of those. No, he didn't.
Zero touchdowns. Really good.
Skip Bayless, you do know zero touchdowns is not good.
So now it's 4th and 7 at the 11, and this is just me. I know Troy Aikman had an issue with this, but I did not have an issue. I'm kicking the field goal because I'm going to, with 6:04 left in the game, I'm going to play to win the game. I'm going to take the points and just say, I can still bring it down and score on you. And if I come down and score, it's not going to be 13-all.
Right.
We're going to win the game.
Right.
So let's take the points.
Right.
Okay? So I was just fine with that. And again, they did have other, you know, one more chance when the tripping penalty had. They had the ball
back.
You
had no chance.
Okay.
Skip Bayless, well, if you thought for that, hold on. You had 58 and a half minutes to move the ball up and down the field and get the ball in the end zone. And you thought the last minute and a half against that defense, that Prescott was going to get the ball in the end zone?
I did until the tripping penalty. It felt special to me. Felt like it had comeback written all over it. It felt like it had 105 and 2 written all over it, as in Brady led at halftime.
You be the man to tell you, the man to bring the kind of packages up there to your neck of the woods. Normally I have to go down, you know, to get my packages.
Do you?
He coming up there to get, because thought you must have been on something, if you thought that was going to drive down the field in the minute and a half.
I do. I live in the flats. You live up in Bel Air.
Wishful thinking. Brady, though, 5-0 against the Cowboys.
5-0, Skip.
So here's my biggest takeaway. In the end, my team is still a game up in the NFC East. And the prelude, the warm-up act for this game featured your Eagles losing another game at home, this one to Russell Wilson, who didn't play all that well in this game. We're about to talk about that in a few minutes.
Mm-hmm.
But the point was, Carson Wentz was a disaster. So do you really think, even though you play, the Eagles play, the easiest closing schedule in football, do you really think they can win out? Because I don't. It didn't look like
a team that
could
win out. I don't think the Cowboys can win out either.
Yeah.
And they've got a short week as well. Does that worry you at all, Skip?
Nope. They will beat Buffalo. And you know what? I'm going to say right here, right now, I think my team is going to win out.
Okay.
I do. I think they're going to go 11-5. They're going to break through and break out. They can beat Buffalo. They can win at Chicago.
They can beat everybody on their roster.
They can beat the Rams. They can win at Philly. They can beat Washington at home. That's what I think will happen.
Okay, well, we heard it here first, and we have so much more to get to when it comes to this game.
Zero.
We got to go into the coaching. We'll talk more about Dak, Zeke, everything there. But, you know, Aaron Rodgers, guys, might be better playing in the cold because last night and the conditions, I don't know, it looked a little bit dangerous. Is he showing he's not an elite QB anymore? We'll